Hello again, astronomers. Our vast universe is full of stars, each at a different point in their billion-year life cycle. And as complex and interesting as stars are, they can create some even more incredible objects all over the universe. Today, we will continue learning about how stars form and change as we take a closer look at massive stars. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to identify each stage in the life cycle of massive stars and explain how their mass impacts these stages. Let's get started. Stars begin in a giant cloud of gas and dust known as a nebula. This cloud is mostly made up of hydrogen and helium. Over time, the particles of these gases begin to pull together due to gravity. As more and more particles clump together, the gravitational pull becomes stronger and stronger, which keeps bringing in even more material. Eventually, the clump gets big enough that the materials collapse from the immense gravitational pull, forming a protostar. Remember, a protostar is a very young star that is still growing and gathering mass. The protostar will continue to gather material due to its gravitational pull. Once it gathers enough material, the core of the protostar gets hotter and hotter. Then it can start the process that powers the star, nuclear fusion. Let's take a minute to recap the process of nuclear fusion. Fusion is when two or more small atoms, which are the smallest unit of matter, come together to make a larger one. When this occurs, energy is released, which lets out a massive amount of light and heat. This is why we can see stars in the night sky. As more and more mass is pulled into a growing protostar, the core where fusion occurs gets hotter and hotter. In average-sized stars, this core is relatively small. In massive stars, the core gains more mass and becomes larger, which makes the temperatures in the core even hotter. These differences in mass and temperature are why average-sized stars and massive stars have different stages in their life cycles. Once the process of nuclear fusion begins within a star, it is considered a main sequence star. This is where the star's path diverges depending on its size. When an average-sized star has used up all of its fuel, it becomes a red giant, followed by a planetary nebula, and finally a white dwarf. A massive star's path is a bit more explosive. Once a massive star has burned through all of its hydrogen fuel via nuclear fusion and only has helium left, it cools down and expands in the same way that red giants do. However, since this star is much larger than an average-sized star, it becomes a red supergiant instead. The supergiant phase lasts for a few million years as the star starts using up the remaining helium in its core instead. This is where things get explosive. Once the red supergiant star has burned through all of its helium too, it has no fuel left, so nuclear fusion stops. Since these stars are so massive, the star completely collapses under its own immense gravity. This creates a giant cosmic explosion called a supernova and marks the end of a massive star's life cycle. This explosion sends a massive amount of energy and material extremely far away into space. It also causes the star's brightness to increase a lot. So much so that if a star we can see from Earth went supernova, it would look like a second sun in the sky. Astronomers will often refer to a supernova as star recycling. Pause the video here and use the information that you've learned so far to record why you think astronomers use this term. The material expelled by a supernova is the same material that forms new stars, so it will eventually form a new nebula and could lead to the creation of brand new stars. The only thing left behind is a dense, hot core of hydrogen and helium gas. This brings us to the last step in the life cycle of massive stars, where their possible path splits off again, depending on their mass. Once a supernova occurs, the remains of the massive star can become either a neutron star or a black hole. Let's explore each one. If the supernova was simply a massive star, its core will collapse into a very dense and incredibly hot object known as a neutron star. They have even more mass than an average-sized star, but it's all squeezed into an object that would fit entirely into the city of Chicago, less than 15 miles across. Remember, the core of an average-sized star ends up as a white dwarf star, which is nearly the same size as the entire Earth. Neutron stars start bigger and end up much smaller, so you can imagine how dense they are. If you could take a single teaspoon of a neutron star's material, it would weigh over a billion tons. On the other hand, if the star that went supernova was extremely massive, it will continue to collapse under its own gravity until it becomes an object with such a strong gravitational pull that not even light can escape its grasp. This incredible phenomenon is called a black hole. Because not even light can escape the clutches of a black hole's gravity, they cannot actually be observed directly. So, how do astronomers study them? Astronomers infer the presence of black holes and study them by detecting their effect on other nearby matter. If a black hole passes through a cloud of interstellar dust, for example, its gravity will draw the dust inward. It can even rip nearby stars apart as it pulls them in toward itself. Astronomers have just recently compiled enough evidence to conclude that the center of our own Milky Way galaxy is a supermassive black hole that the entire galaxy revolves around. But don't worry, even though black holes have immense gravitational pull, they're small in comparison to our entire galaxy, so we won't ever fall into its clutches. Now that you've learned all about the life cycle of both average-sized stars and massive stars, let's recap. All stars start in nebulas when gases condense into a protostar. When they're big enough, they start nuclear fusion and become main-sequence stars. Then, the paths of average-sized stars and massive stars diverge. A massive star will become a red supergiant after it has exhausted its fuel. Due to its mass, it will then collapse and explode in an event called a supernova. Lastly, a supernova will become either a neutron star or a black hole, depending on its mass. Be sure to complete the practice questions and extension activities that go with this lesson as you continue your journey into the universe. And as always, remember, you are out of this world. Hey, hey.